on standards for performing quality dialysis. Now, we all know an efficient dialysis unit is the backbone of every nephrology department. When I trained, we were told that all problems start in dialysis and end in dialysis. Keep your dialysis unit happy and going. To have a successful transplant program, you need to have an efficient and relatively complication-free hemodialysis unit. And every critical care unit needs the backup of good quality dialysis. And hence, the need for standards and the application, all aspects of dialysis for optimal outcomes. This is going to be the structure of my talk, because for optimal dialysis, you need optimal quality of water, you need good access, adequacy has to be ideal, and other things. So I'll come to all of them. Coming to water quality for dialysis, we all know that the hemodialysis patient is exposed to about 360 liters of water a week. We all aware of that. And if there are any contaminants in this water, it goes directly to the bloodstream via the dialyzer membrane. And this shows the toxic effects of various contaminants in dialysis. I'm sure we're all familiar with this, so I'll skip this. And this is a schematic diagram of a water treatment system for hemodialysis. And once the water has been purified by the RO system, and then the RO distribution system can either be a direct feed system or an indirect feed system. The direct feed system directly delivers the product water from the RO unit to the loop for distribution. Whereas if there is an indirect feed, this involves a storage tank in between, and this accumulates to product water, which is then delivered to the distribution loop. The unused portion of this water is then recirculated back into the storage tank. Coming to what is the standard for this, the standard is a continuous loop design. This has been recommended by AMI. And there should be no dead ends or multiple branches in the distribution system, as these are places where the bacterial microfilm can grow. This is the chemical quality standards for water used in dialysis application in US. And there are a number of substances which can be toxic to the patient. And there are maximum levels of standards that are applicable. And one should test, the chemical quality should be tested at least once in 6 months. This is the maximum recommended dose of microbial contaminants in the water used for dialysis. And what is followed is the AMI standards 2011. The maximum number of level of bacteria in the water used to prepare dialysis fluid, this should not exceed 100 colony-forming units. And the AMI action level is 50 colony-forming units. An action level is defined as the point at which measures must be taken to correct the potential source of contamination to remain in compliance with the AMI standards. Coming to endotoxin standard, the maximum level of endotoxin in the water should not exceed 0.25 endotoxin units per ml. And the action level again is half of that, that is 0.125 endotoxin units per ml. Coming to ultra-pure dialysis solution, we all know the positives of ultra-pure dialysis. It decreases CRP and other inflammatory mediators, improves response to erythropoietin, it reduces plasma levels of B2 microglobulin amongst other things. And for preparing ultra-pure dialysis, the bacterial level should be below 0.1 colony-forming units per ml, and the endotoxin level should be below 0.03 endotoxin units per ml. How frequently should we test our water? Chemical testing should be done at least once 6 monthly, and for testing for bacteria and other endotoxins should be tested monthly. If the standards are exceeded, then testing should be performed weekly till the problem is resolved. So the key for water quality is to maintain is the establishment of a facility-specific quality management program for water treatment and distribution. It should detail management practices, describe a structured monitoring program designed to verify satisfactory operation, and most importantly, it should be fully documented with clearly delineated lines of responsibility. Coming to vascular access, what are the standards to be followed? All patients should have an AV fistula made in CKD stage 4 or when the anticipated start of dialysis is less than 6 months away. What is preferred is a radiocephalic fistula on the non-dominant arm. That's the first choice. I think we've already discussed that previously. When you're going to cannulate a fistula, the rule of 6 should be followed. This should be used when to use an AV fistula. Is it ready to use or not? It should be done at least 6 months from the time of creation. A vein of at least 6 millimeters in diameter with cleanly distinguishable margin should be there. A cannulation length of at least 6 centimeters from the anastomotic side should be available. A flow rate of at least 600 ml per minute with a cannulation depth of not more than 6 millimeters should be there. And there should be no evidence of venous hypertension. What is recommended is a railroading rather than a buttonhole technique, because the buttonhole technique is more likely to cause anusmal dilatation. But that's open to debate. I'm sure these recommendations have already been discussed before, but 65% or more of the patients starting dialysis should do so with an AV fistula, and 90% or more of the prevalent patients should dialyze with an AV fistula at any point of time in a dialysis unit. These are the recommendations. And since a significant number of patients already have CKD stage 5 by the time they are diagnosed, or they need dialysis in a short period of time, they could be initiated with a temporary access, and the attempt should be to create a permanent access as soon as possible. If a temporary access is required, then the right internal jugular double lumen dialysis catheter is the temporary access of choice. As far as possible, the subclavian vein should not be cannulated, because even a single cannulation can lead to about 35% risk of stenosis. If a femoral dialysis catheter is used, it should not be retained for more than 5 to 7 days, and never in the outpatient setting. The right femoral vein should be avoided cannulation, especially in patients who are potential candidates for transplantation. And I would assume that every patient is a potential candidate for a transplant. So as possible, one should avoid the right femoral vein. Vascular access monitoring, that should always be done. The maximum blood flow that is obtained from the access should be recorded in each dialysis. And if there is a problem with the fistula, then a fistula or a graft stenosis should be evaluated by a fistulogram. You may use ultrasonography, but that's operator dependent. So what is recommended is the fistulogram. Coming to hemodialysis adequacy, the delivered dose of hemodialysis should be measured at regular intervals, and this could be done either by measurement of the KT of, by calculating the KT upon V, or by calculation of the urea reduction ratio. What is minimally adequate dialysis? This has been delineated, but what is the ideal level? Nobody knows. The minimally adequate dialysis is 3 times a week, and a KTV of IV up of 1.2 or a URR of 65%. And to achieve this, one should target a slightly higher dose, so maybe a KTV by V of 1.3 and a URR of about around 70%. In patients who have minimal residual renal function, one could target an even higher level of KT upon V so as to maintain adequacy. And one should also not forget that the dose of dialysis should not be based solely on these numbers. Other factors need to be considered. One is the potassium being adequately removed? Is the patient having hyperkalemia in spite of dialysis? Is the dialysis, is the acidosis being corrected adequately? A pre-dialysis bicarbonate should be more than 20. Is the patient's fluid removal adequate? Is he in fluid overload in spite of dialysis? And is he malnourished or not? Good blood pressure control is extremely important, because that improves patient outcomes. The U should be optimal so that the patient remains euvolemic and normotensive. It is important to restrict the sodium intake. And increasing the interdialytic positive sodium balance, this should be avoided, because often these patients are hypotensive and there is a tendency to increase the dialysis sodium. And this can lead to a positive sodium balance. So one should watch out for that. Coming to dialysis membranes, biocompatible synthetic or modified cellulose membranes should be preferred over unmodified cellulose membranes. And we should always use bicarbonate as the buffer. Use of acetate containing solutions are to be discouraged. Dialysate containing glucose is preferred over glucose-free dialysate. This increases risk of hypoglycemia. So dialysate containing glucose is always preferred. And if we are reusing the dialyzer, then automatic reprocessing should be done. And thereafter, performance testing should be done for all reused dialyzers. This includes total cell volume, which should be more than 80%. And if the total cell volume falls below 80%, then the dialyzer should be discarded. Pressure leak testing should be done to test the integrity of the membrane. And we should always calculate the KT upon V. This should be done monthly for new as well as reused dialyzers. What about HCV patients? A patient who comes for hemodialysis should be tested for hepatitis C virus, either when they initiate dialysis or when they transfer from another facility. And what is recommended is that in units which have a low prevalence of hepatitis C virus, initial testing could be by ELISA. And if it is positive, this could be followed by nucleic acid testing. In those units which have a high prevalence of hepatitis C, initial testing could be by nucleic acid testing. These are KDOQI guidelines. And patients who test negative, one could retest 6-monthly or 12-monthly. Testing for patients who have an abnormal amino transferase level rise should be tested with nucleic acid testing. And if there's a new HCV infection in the hemodialysis unit and that's suspected to be nosocomial, then testing with nucleic acid testing should be performed for all patients who maybe have been exposed. And those patients who are negative, also retesting could be done 2 to 12 weeks later. so as to prevent any patients being not diagnosed who might have been in the window period. This is a diagram of the testing process, which I've already talked about. All units should ensure implementation of adherence to the strict infection control procedures, and isolation for hepatitis C is not recommended as an alternative to strict infection control procedures. The use of dedicated machines for hepatitis C as per KDOQI is not recommended, and wherever dialyzer reuse is unavoidable, it is suggested that the dialyzers be reused provided there is implementation of and adherence to the strict infection control procedures. What about hepatitis B positive patients? Since the hepatitis B virus is readily transmitted across the filter membrane, reuse is not recommended. Patient education is extremely important, and they should be dialyzed in a separate room with separate machines, separate equipment, instruments and supplies. And staff, what is extremely important is that staff members who are taking care of the hepatitis B positive patients should not be taking care of the negative patients at the same point of time. For HIV, again, isolation is not recommended, but what is recommended is adherence to strict infection control procedures. What are the standards for precautions for healthcare workers? Three from basic things are perform hand hygiene frequently, use of personal protective equipment, and follow safe injection practices. Like I said, hand hygiene should be performed frequently, and it's extremely important to perform hand hygiene before when we move from one patient to the other. This applies for the dialysis technician as well as for the doctors. Use of personal protective equipment is extremely important again, and one should remember not to use the same pair of gloves for more than one patient. Safe injection practices should be propagated. And what is again important is that multi-dose vials, which are often present for heparin and as well as for the local anesthetic, should be used for only one patient and not for multiple patients. Vaccination, I'm sure we all aware of it, but just to complete the list, hepatitis B vaccination is mandatory, and we should check the antibody titers once the vaccination has been completed. Boosters to be given in case the titers are not up to the level, that is 10 milliunits per ml. Hepatitis, then pneumococcal vaccination should be offered to every patient as well as the influenza vaccine. What about anemia management? The target now that is recommended is about 10 to 11 milligram per deciliter, and all efforts should be maintained to maintain the patient within this level. What about nutritional status? We need to remember that protein energy malnutrition is often present in the patients when they initiate dialysis, and this often begins in CKD stage 3 or stage 4. So, and if it is there, it's a strong predictor of poor clinical outcome. What is recommended is a protein intake of 1.2 grams per day of high biological value and a calorie intake of about 30 to 35 kilocalories per day. So in summary, to achieve good outcomes for dialysis patient requires a multi-pronged approach, and a regular training program for the dialysis staff is essential to maintain quality and keep them abreast with current practices. Thank you very much.